Hi guys and welcome to another vlog. I am riding this. This is the Kawasaki versus 1000. Straight away I'm going to put the key inside so that I can actually show you the lights as well. So here you go. And you know what? It does a full swipe up when you turn it on. Again, let's just see that. Could have been slightly clearer this screen. But here, when I turn it on, it does a full swipe up. Plenty of information on offer. But it's an analog digital unit. Actually, it's very nice looking unit, something which we've seen in other Kawasaki bikes as well. Now the lights are similar, or actually evolved from the ZX6R. So yeah, Kawasaki is having a lot of similar design elements. Looks very sharp indeed, but this is a massive motorcycle. It gets all LEDs, LED lights, LED indicators, everything is LED. The bike is massive in terms of size, but it looks little out of proportion because in spite of the massive bodywork, it runs on 17-inch wheels. Yeah, these are regular sport bike tires, 120 section up front. You get dual 310mm petrol discs up front, obviously. And you got this reflector on the side. There's the horn, you can see that. That beak looks really nice as well. It says Kawasaki versus 1000. This paint scheme is actually quite impressive because it's white and black and a mix of all of those things. That is the engine. Yes, it's an inline four, and obviously sounds really very nice. The exhaust gets dual port treatment, and the rear tire happens to be a 180 section. Again, a petrol disc, and you can adjust the suspension from here. So it's adjustable for preload, of course, and rebound as well, but everything is manually adjustable. In fact, you know, you can adjust the suspension at the front also, but it has to be done manually. This visor can be adjusted too. Again, it has to be done manually, everything manually, but the windscreen visor is actually tall enough. The mirrors offer, I mean, we will talk about it when riding, but has a nice and different sort of a shape. 21 liters for the fuel tank capacity, and I mean, it has slots to attach your luggage, panniers and all. See, very easy. Yeah, this is actually for touring, not really for off-roading. The rear light also looks very nice. Again, all LED here as well. And here you can put a top box as well. Meanwhile, the Sari Guard is like a barbecue griller. It's big and it looks ugly AF. Coming to the seats, they are humongous. I think this is one of the most comfortable motorcycles. Look at the size of the seats. Super duper cushioning, and of course, big in terms of size as well. And the handlebar is very wide indeed. Okay, now you get a power outlet right there. Yeah, there's a power outlet right there. And it's as easy to turn the motorcycle on as just pressing this button, which you will come to in a bit. You can press the select button. What does it do? Well, it tells you a lot of units, and you can, you know, actually reset these units and browse through them. What you need to do is actually press this button to browse through. It's telling you the battery voltage, it's telling you a lean angle. This is on the right side, this is on the left side. And all these settings, including a clock, of course. And I mean, you can decide when you want the shift light to come to. So we're just going to get out of it here. You see, I can program it, and I'm taking it all the way to 10,000 RPM. Okay, just reset below to 3,000 something, something, something RPM. Here, I'm just going to put it back to 8,000 RPM, just so that I think that is the right way to do it. So we're just going to come out of this for a moment. Yeah, let's just come out of that. I'll just like turn on and off the motorcycle. See, it does a full swipe up very nicely. You get the fuel meter, gear position indicator, clock, speedometer, and digital you get. This is analog tachometer, telltale lights everywhere, and it's saying power full. Now you keep this power button pressed, and then you can actually browse through increasing or decreasing the power output here. L means for low. Meanwhile, this is for the traction control button. You can also set that. This is for cruise control. This is the pass light switch, adjustable levers, of course. And you know what? This is for the hazard light. Yeah, the hazard light button. This is for the indicator. Switch gear is actually very easy to use. Let's do one thing. Let's turn on the motorcycle. It's as easy as, yeah, there it turns on. Rolls to life. You can see the lights. I'm just gonna change that if you wanna see how they work on all the beams. There you see. Yeah, the bike is a bit dirty because I don't know what Dhanil is up to with on the motorcycle as such. Says versus, right? Just in case you forget which bike you're riding, but the position is such, I don't think you're going to remember any which ways to read this, of course. And here the bike, okay? Sounds so freaking smooth, but you know, the proportions look ungainly. However, let's start riding right away. All right, we're all set to go turning on the motorcycle, and there it rose to life into first gear, and off we go straight away. Let me tell you, my goodness, it's so smooth.
Oh my god, it picks up speed in no time at all, but there's so much wind right now, now somehow around the corners, let me tell you, you kind of feel the weight, but still it's very manageable. Okay, it's not as easy to ride as say a Ducati Multistrada, because you can feel that 255 kgs of weight, but for the most part it's very easy handling motorcycle, like nimble, agile enough for its weight and size. But the problem is it's so big now, it's so big that there is just too much wind to contend with, especially at higher speeds. You're like, let me fight the wind, and you really cannot, because this bike has so much bulk to move around. But smoothness, my goodness, it feels really smooth, very refined and super punchy as well. Braking performance is good, yeah, definitely good, very nicely calibrated ABS, but somehow I think the initial bite is not that great, and then there's so much grip on offer. Onto the gas in third gear also, look at the way it moves, any gear you pull it, it just responds so beautifully well. This is a very nice engine, it's an inline 4-cylinder engine, it's a 1000cc unit, which it shares with the Kawasaki Ninja 1000, of course, and there is so much grunt now. Okay, riding in the city, no problem at all, because it doesn't heat, it's very rideable, heat management is very well done, and it just feels at home in spite of having such a massive engine. Okay, and somehow it jinks into corners very smoothly and nicely. Ride quality is very awesome, suspension does a great job, but you can feel that it has some amount of stiffness. That stiffness obviously can be felt here, but for the most part ride quality is very good. Obviously it has to be stiff, because the kind of speeds it can do above 230 kilometers per hour. Only thing is you need to really duck down, and these mirrors are kind of useless on the outer edges. On the outer edges doesn't feel so good, the mirrors. For the most part though, you won't complain, because you really have to rarely have to see the mirrors on the highway. Of course you have to see the mirrors, you can't ignore that fact. Okay, sounds super smooth, super nice. Now this engine actually produces 120 horsepower at 9000 rpm, and torque output is also quite impressive, which peaks in at 7500 rpm. There's so much wind buffeting somehow now, I don't know why it has so much wind buffeting. Anyways, what you're going to do is we are going to put it into first gear. Yeah, into first gear, brakes are sharp, okay, and off we go. First gear 92, second gear 127. Oh god, don't ask me, only the performance is absolutely crazy. And then you can actually come to sixth gear straight away, and then you realize when you're in sixth gear now, this bike feels at home even at 60 kilometers per hour. That is a level of grunt on offer, that is a level of performance on offer. Overtakes absolutely effortless on this bike. Now the power modes it has, which are two power modes, what it does is in low power mode it cuts power by cuts power to 75%, so 90 horsepower is what the power output becomes in low power mode, while in full mode it's like 120 horsepower, which might seem less for a liter class motorcycle, but this is not a super bike, this is a sports tourer. The torque output is actually 102 newton meters, which comes in at 7500 rpm. This engine feels super tractable, super punchy, and all throughout the rev range it just has a grunt, has grunt and even more of it. Okay, make a downshift and you can simply fly. That is the kind of performance we are talking about. Making a lane change, no problem at all. Now the thing is that this bike is priced at rupees 14.23 lakhs on road Mumbai, which is actually very affordable for the kind of performance it has to offer. It's not an off-road motorcycle, it's a more of a sports tourer. You can actually take it for mild off-road trails at best, but you know, because of the tires being more road-centric, road-biased, wouldn't really advise you to take it off the road. Yeah, ground clearance is also less at around 150 mm, I believe, so that again is a small, not a big, small bummer. Smoothness is so good in this bike, I'm really impressed by how smooth this bike is. But then inline 4 is something you would always expect should be smooth, and it is, of course it has to be. The good thing is that the gearbox is also super smooth shifting, and the clutch is also light, and then the brakes, they always impress me, like really strong stopping power. There, we stopped, hazard lights on, hazard light off, into first gear, off we go. ₹10,000 rpm red line. Performance is maddening to say the least, it's really very good. And this is a bike which offers a lot of usable power. Now there are three traction modes, okay, 1, 2, 3 and off. In one it's the least intrusive, which actually makes you wheelie. Right now we're on 2, and then there's 3, which is very intrusive indeed, and if you turn it off then this bike can flip with the kind of grunt it has to offer. Absolutely insane the amount of thrust this bike has, so yeah, you have to be a little careful in that regard. it's such a joy to use this clutch on this bike. And then, you know, I was thinking this would be really difficult to ride because of its size, but somehow it's not. It's actually quite usable, a bike, in the sense that you can actually flick it right, left and center. Only thing is, at lower speed you have to be a little careful, because then you have to see how you're judging the handlebar. The handlebar is really very wide. The mirrors, well, I really wish they don't do all these design elements on mirrors, because that kind of ruins what all you can see around. See, I mean, there was no necessity for this curvature on the mirror, and that kind of ruins things. Ride is, you can see, little stiffness can be felt, but for the most part, I have very little to complain about this bike. Okay, we are into first gear, and every time I get on the throttle, listen to this, okay? Here we go. I don't know why there's just so much wind blast on this bike at the moment, but this is a bike, you just can ride in first or second gear. You don't need to go into any other gear if you want to just enjoy the performance and the rush. Okay, let me be honest, in full power mode, it kind of feels a little snappy on full throttle, especially in the top end of the rev range. That feeling you don't get in the low power mode, of course, because it just feels so much more composed, and because it obviously cuts down the, not only the power, but also the response from this motor. Otherwise, it's very aggressive. It's got an IMU, because of which it's got cornering ABS, and of course, I told you about traction control as well. That too is present, which is something which is normal on a bike of this price and segment. But you know what Kawasaki should do? Kawasaki should give it even more power and maybe add another mode, like a mid mode, because there's low and full. There should be a mid mode too, because I think the low mode is just too underpowered and the full mode is just too powerful. So somewhere in between, we need to sit for a more relaxed riding experience. And this is a bike which can ride all day long at triple digit speeds and gobble up kilometers and miles without any hesitation. And because you sit so high, there is this high center of gravity when you try to push it around corners and all. But honestly, you wouldn't want to, and you shouldn't be pushing this motorcycle around the corners, because this is not a motorcycle which likes to corner hard, simply put, because that weight is there, and that weight especially will increase in case you happen to have a pillion or happen to have luggage as well. And then you realize this is more about gobbling up the kilometers effortlessly, and that's the reason why you would actually like this bike over, say, the Ninja 1000, which is also a very capable motorcycle, which actually feels like a better bet somehow. You know why? Because the Ninja 1000 obviously looks better and handles better as well, but you know what, the Ninja 1000 feels a bit too fast and a little less comfortable when compared to this versus 1000. That said, I think Kawasaki has done a fantastic job. Only thing is, they really need to focus on the sales and service network, because what I'm hearing from people that the sales and service outlets are a bit few, plus the cost of upkeep is also on the higher side, so they really need to resolve that. Obviously, if you have that kind of budget, you won't really care so much about upkeep costs, especially if you're buying a 14-15 lakh motorcycle. But yeah, if you're going to buy an entry level, say a Ninja 300, you would definitely care about it a lot more. No false neutrals, absolutely comes into neutral like child's play. So guys, this is my vlog of the Kawasaki versus 1000. I think it's a fantabulous machine, really punchy in terms of performance, really nice in the way it moves, and definitely a bike which, if you like this kind of a design, you would take to it. Only thing is, the wheels are small, but those small wheels actually help in the handling, so I'm not going to complain much about that. I think it's a boon the way they've designed this motorcycle. It's a mild muncher, and looking at the way new highways are coming in India, I'm sure this versus 1000 will definitely appeal to those who like to go cross cities or cross states on two wheels. A fab motorcycle. And if you like this vlog, make sure to give it a thumbs up. Wo sab bol to chuka hu na. To abhi sprite right pee lo. Video khatam karte hain. Bye bye. Take care. See you.